First of all, I appreciate the opportunity to follow two strong female leaders in our industry. We need more of that, so thank you. I'm also excited to be here in this emerging market. It's super exciting to see game development areas, new growth. There's opportunities for new learning, new solutions, new partnerships. Activision and Blizzard and King are companies. We have about 40 different studios and offices around the world, and we're continuing to expand. Our most recent regions are Mexico, Australia, and even Poland. So there's tons of opportunity to find artists and companies to partner with or even build new studios in regions like this. So that's one of the key takeaways here is, as we go through this, I'm gonna sort of make it up as we go. I let the visuals speak for themselves. I'll give you a little background on myself. You'll see how my brain works through the visuals. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna ramp this up and I'm gonna drive it off a cliff. So while we're watching, I want you to, there's no direct takeaways. This is all about inspiration. I want you to find the opportunities or the solutions or the takeaways, the things that inspire you, or maybe find a little nugget or a little solution. I'll show you, this is more about convergence of thinking. It's about philosophies of finding outlier technologies, or when you're doing production, to sort of hide the research in the opportunity. If you go ask for permission, or if you tell somebody the real budget, it will never happen. So while you're doing it, make it fresh, build on it next time. And so I'll dig into some of that as I go. It'll start to make sense. So this is, am I aging myself here? Has anybody seen E.T.? I was 10 years old, it was 1982, and that year was super inspirational to me as a you know, growing child and learning about the world and, you know, being, to me, the real thing that resonated was the anti-hero, right? Doing the right thing for the good, but not for the credit. So movies like Blade Runner and Road Warrior really inspired me. And so I decided I was going to go into something that was technical and artistic and then had a moral or ethical delivery to as many people as possible. And that, I decided, was through the visual medium. This here is actually my studio in San Francisco at ILM. They had happened to one day be parking a bunch of famous film props in there. And so when nobody was paying attention, I hopped on. And it's awesome because this bike was used in the behind the scenes making, it was actually used in the film, but also behind the scenes experience at Universal Studios that I saw when I was 10. So for me to be able to actually jump on and ride the bike was quite a treat. You couldn't go to school for special effects or visual effects or computer graphics or game development back in the 80s, let's say, 80s, 90s. So I went and I decided this is what I was gonna do. So I went the high route and I just studied mechanical engineering. And that was sort of overkill for getting into the film industry for doing pyrotechnics and stunt cars and all that kind of fun stuff. And it was, when I was interning, I was designing animatronics. And I realized animatronics was leading to computer animation and computers were gonna simulate everything. And so I pivoted at that point from mechanical and special effects into visual effects and computer graphics. And so that's a key takeaway is about understanding yourself, but also looking for opportunities in the industry. Watch the innovations, see how markets change, especially in the games industry, it pivots fast. So you can be invested in a product in 2 years, 3 years into development. And if that market's not there, you're gonna have to shift. It's a dangerous thing when you don't have a lot of backing, but it's something that you need to pay attention to as a product builder in this industry. Our consumers are finicky, trends change rapidly. So let's just pay attention to that. So I got lucky to, one of my first projects out of school was to figure out how to do digital humans on a movie that nobody knew anything about at the time. And I was 23. It happened to be the top grossing film of all time. And a lot of the people in the deck chair are actually me. So they asked me to animate a library of people, and I said, well, I'm just gonna use motion capture, and I'd give me a deck chair, right? And so I built the library of digital humans pretty rapidly and solved that problem. And so from there I got recruited on to do the Star Wars prequels. And so at 25 I was working for George Lucas and doing Star Wars, and it ended up that I spent the next two decades working on about every top grossing film that you could see: Star Wars, Harry Potter, Pirates of the Caribbean, Transformers, you name it. The thing was that I saw a gap in the industry. Nobody was paying attention to how do you replicate reality in computer graphics. So sure, we have a bunch of visual effects artists and a bunch of software was evolving, but nobody was paying attention to what can I do to extract the lighting from a real world location, or to extract the motion or emotion of a character and translate that into another character. So I spent two decades doing that, and that was pretty phenomenal. Along the way, I used a bunch of outlier technologies, different ways of thinking. So this was in 1999, I believe, working with Steven Spielberg on AI. We decided to use Unreal 1, the game engine, to visualize the shots in the movie so that Spielberg could actually look at his movie before he ever made it. Then we took those game assets and we did real-time compositing on the movie set. We engineered this entire system, hardware from the broadcast industry and the games industry, to do something that had never been done. And this allowed for super efficient filming. You'll see when this goes to blue screen how hard it is to visualize stuff on a movie set. But this first take was the take they put in the movie because they nailed it. They knew exactly where they were going. This is what you would normally see, right? It's super difficult to come up with that. So this is what we would do. We would think about outlier technologies. We would hide the investment in production dollars, and we would solve advanced problems to make a better product. Of course, in post-production, we would go back in and up-res all the visuals and the rendering and the lighting, and all the passes. This is something still today that hasn't converged. It's getting super close, but it's not quite there, that you can't get full photo reel all the time in camera, but we're getting close. So here's another concept. While at Industrial Light & Magic, we had a games division, so I did work on some AAA stuff as well. This was The Force Unleashed. They asked us to do a novel marketing campaign for them. So I said, why don't I do, I can merge the news person or the PR person into the game and have them play against The Apprentice. So the reason we had access to these games is we were actually using the digital double technology that we were using in film to generate the actors for these games, and this was 10, 15 years ago. So this was super early, and this obviously is pointing to what you see today in virtual production. And this was all experimental, zero cost to us because we had these advanced labs, all of this film technology. And then we pushed it further. Well, what if I believe this is, we're using Unreal 3 here. What if we used all these technologies to make a Star Wars movie in real time in the game engine? Is that possible? Absolutely. It's very difficult. You need a bunch of technology, a lot of pre-planning. You have to build all these assets. This is still sort of not a thing yet, right? Because filmmakers still want complete control over the shots, the camera, the editorial, the post-production. But this proves the point in the future of the technologies, right? This is all real-time graphics in engine. This was, you know, a good 10 years ago. And that all led to, of course, ties back into what you saw a little bit earlier, the virtual production from The Mandalorian. So this is the point where I diverged from the film industry and I decided the 100 years worth of linear filmmaking was a little stale. And this is some of the prototype material that convinced me to move forward. So what we were doing was using multiple render nodes, stereo projection, and prototyping what it would look like if you walked into a scene of a movie. What if your living room was a projection of that environment, of that movie? It'd be a much more immersive experience. This is Bob Iger here actually playing with a dinosaur in Jurassic Park. And to him, it looks like it's right in front of him because he's driving the perspective of the rendering. So this is super phenomenal technology. It's light years ahead of what we potentially could be seeing in our living rooms. Blows away virtual reality because it's visceral. You have your full vision, it's driven from your perspective, it's phenomenal. Not quite a product. But this is what told me, you know what? Time to go to the games side. Because the studio, the film studios aren't the best place for this kind of innovation. The game studios are. And so that's when I pivoted over to Activision Blizzard. And this was almost a decade ago. And so what I did is I took all of the innovation and thinking from the film industry, and now that the game engines are getting to that point and the visuals and the graphics are pretty much there, let's use all the same stuff. Let's start writing stories. Let's start casting A-list actors. Let's use their full likeness, their movement, their facial expressions, their nuance, everything, and start really selling these games. And not only that, but let's get into the hardcore technology of this. So we partnered up with USC's Institute of Creative Technology and built this light stage. Once again, this was 10 years ago. Now all the games, major publishers, I think, have one of these. It's some various flavor. But at the time, this was designed for digital stunt face replacement. So if, you know, Will Smith's stunt double jumped off a building and they needed to replace the face, then we would bring him in and shoot his face, composite it in. We took this technology and we turned it into something that was the inverse of that. How do you decompose somebody's face? How do you decompose the lighting? How does the light impact the face? How do we extract all the layers? Specularity, bump, gloss, everything about the face that we could decompose. Also, we put 4D systems in here, so full four-dimensional recording the face and every nuance and wrinkle, and nonverbal cues, everything. And it's also nonlinear as well, so when you make an expression, you don't just go from one expression to the next. You actually go through a whole range of muscle firing. So we can decode all this mathematically. This is how we build face rigs. And at the time, we were taking this data through three lateral. We were leveraging them, of course, to build some blend shape rigs. One of the interesting points about emerging markets is there's plenty of opportunity to build companies that solve problems and innovate, that either collaborate or get bought by larger entities. And so in that case, because they were bought and there wasn't a comparable solution on the market, we ended up building our own procedural rig building solution. And then here's some of the data you see that just feeds that. But at the time, digital humans weren't that great in the engine. And even today, with MetaHuman and everything else, they've advanced pretty far, but they're still not where I think that they should be. So this is a test we did about 7-8 years ago, and we reevaluated everything we did in the industry. What resolution of mesh, what resolution of texture, what texture packages, what face solver, what performance capture method, what rendering technologies, skin shaders, all that stuff. And so this, we took 6 months, I took my engineering teams offline and solved this problem to the point where we could get pre-render assets and in-game assets delivered from the same pipeline. They're still divergent, of course, because of the just different rendering architectures. But no animator touched this. No artist touched this. And so it's capable. But we're still not to the point where we can just feed this to the engine, put a dozen of these characters in, and have it do its thing. So that's what's exciting to me, is there's endless problems in this industry. Here's an example I pulled from the internet, some ideas of where can we take this. These are some generative AI examples. So we're working on these solutions for our pipeline. Some things we've had for years. Other things are just new. We're building our own data sets so that we have clean libraries to work from. But here's an example of how you can do text-to-generative concept art to do character building. And then we can take these ideas rapidly. And once again, in convergence, using sort of the film paradigm, we actually cast the likeness of the characters we want. We bring in prop masters and wardrobe experts, and we kit these characters up in real life until the art director likes the look. And then we do full photogrammetry, beauty texture, marketing material, everything. We take all the pieces off and they send them through an automated photogrammetry prop pipeline. So there's a couple opportunities in the industry here. We outsource a lot of this work. Our games, we end up, I think I mentioned, we may use up to 100 companies for different technology solutions, including art assets, cleanup, photogrammetry, all kinds of stuff. Our games are so big that we can't do it all in-house. So that's just another opportunity if you're out there thinking about, you know, you love artistry, maybe you want to start an outsourcing company. We're also hiring people regionally, so we can even do remote talent to help us with these characters. So this, we also can do this with environments, right? It's getting very interesting. And I've even seen some of the AI start to generate full environments as well as full linear content. I'm still not a fan because it comes from whatever your library is, and most libraries are not diverse or they're not comprehensive. And one of the, you'll see a lot of the, you know, like ChatGPT, of course, most of that learning model is based off of text, not dialogue. So if you're writing a film, it's not necessarily the right solution. So just things to think about when you talk about using AI. We pay attention to this, and there's a super growth opportunity here. But what we do is then we tend to go back to traditional methods. We use Google Earth. From that concept art, we'll come in and find locations around the world in Google Earth, Street View. Then we'll hire photographers or photogrammetry companies around the world to go on those locations, to shoot those environments, to shoot the lighting reference. And then we have a rapid feedback loop where we quickly throw some of that material into reality capture, start making rough in assets. We'll throw those assets into our gray box and then give feedback to the artists that are still on location about our playthroughs, our walkthroughs, which things do we want more detail on, where do we need the materials. And we can rapidly get all this base material, send it straight to our third parties to build these assets and clean them up, and then feed them back through the loop. One of the interesting things we do is the actual walkthroughs of these real-world environments. So somebody will literally walk through what they think the gameplay of that environment should be, and then we do a one-to-one in engine of all the materials and lighting conditions of that environment to try to make it as real as possible. So we pay attention to as much detail as possible. So a lot of what we're doing about the human nuance and the light material responsive in these environments, it has to do with extended engagement through empathy. We're trying to hit those subtle cues, the subconscious cues about believability that keep you engaged in the content. And then, so one of the points about lighting, back to our friend here, we had an art director say during the pandemic he wanted to shoot a realistic lighting reference of our character. So they flew out to the desert and they shot this guy in the desert. And they did a one-to-one look development in the game engine from the lighting environment and everything. And I said, well, you know, that was a lot of money to go to one location and one time a day with one character. Why didn't you give me a call? Because I can outdo that. And how do I outdo it? It all comes back around, right? So what I did is I loaded a game level into a virtual environment studio, and I brought our kitted up actor into that studio. And I did look for development photography, scanning, and rapid environment change, lighting condition change, so that we can do all of this stuff, forwards and backwards look development of a realistic character in the game and the game lighting realistically on the character. While I was there, I said, you know what else we can do? We can start to evaluate how we make games and design games. We can start to worry about set dressing. We can walk through our levels so it's visceral, right? Instead of a playthrough. You can use your peripheral vision while you're designing. We can direct game campaign as if it was a film. Now we get into linear. If I'm dropping new content in a version of Call of Duty, why wouldn't I drop an episodic dramatic series on Netflix at the same time? Now I'm extending my brand, I'm engaging non-gamers in our content, and it's super cost effective. And so here's just a quick example of what that would look like. No visual effects. The dynamic lighting is actually driven from an infrared tracker on the gun. And this is a full virtual environment with a live actor, practical lighting, CG lighting in the level, and no post-production. And I did all of this pretty much myself. So this is where things are heading, right? Now, the reason that it's not here today is because the Call of Duty brand is so big and so strong from our player base that a linear experience has to be so good that it doesn't undersell the brand. The other thing is, this is not necessarily universal content. We were waiting for the industry to start to prove that there was a convergence of game IP into linear IP, and we have seen many failures on that front. Until recently, here's a great example. Great cinematic game, super fun to play, great storyline, and they turn it into a linear product. Super successful. And there's a couple reasons this works. 4 or 5 years ago, it wouldn't have worked. If it was released as a feature film, it wouldn't have worked. There's a couple reasons. If this was released as a gamer-specific property, only the gamers would watch it. If this was released as a film, there's not a value proposition. It would be considered game or sci-fi, but because people already pay for a subscription, they'll watch the content because it's already paid for. We just went through a pandemic, so there's some empathy here. We understand survivability. We understand the context. Obviously, we don't have zombies running around, but so it's a lot more sellable. So the point here is you have to be very smart about when you take your property and push it into other mediums. Also, they brought on strong writers. They embellished story moments that maybe weren't strong in the game or maybe even weren't in the game. So there's a key point takeaway in game design here, though. When I watched the series, there were moments when I was like, I kind of remember that, but not really. And that's because I had agency. And this is why games sell. Agency matters. You have control of the content. It's your story. So if you're trying to be told a story and trying to drive the story at the same time, there's a disconnect. There are different parts of the brain. So this is a really interesting takeaway for me. Was I was like, well, this totally works, because they had a writer go in and they, you know, polish these things up, these moments up. But what if you could merge those? What would that look like? This is an example of some of that, right? Netflix tried this about 5 years ago, Bandersnatch. And what's interesting is the linear content is about game development, right? And so you have, they cheated. They basically sold you that you're talking about a game and playing a game, so they tried to trick you to subconsciously engage in the content. But the reality is that doesn't work. Because when you make the content stop for me to make a conscious choice, you've taken me out of the story. That doesn't work. So better, potentially, is maybe Netflix makes a deal with Amazon and they look at your consumer analytics, and then when they get to this point in the storyline, they pick the product you are most likely to pick automatically, giving you a tailored experience based on your consumption analytics. Just a thought. Or maybe pupil tracking. Whichever one you stare at longer, it automatically goes to. You're still consciously in the storyline. Or maybe Spotify, right? They tapped you into Spotify, you pick the song you're more likely to pick, you get a customized experience. Is that a game? Absolutely. Here's the logic tree of that entire episode. It's a simple game, and the reason they don't do this at large scale is because it's very costly to shoot linear content for all of these divergent moments. But think about that. What if it was in a photoreal game engine? You only pay to make the game once, now you diverge the linear story through cost effectively. So they got smart and they pivoted. They put it into animation, right? For two reasons. Number one, animation's cheaper. And number two, the young age consumers haven't been trained into being told linear stories at the scale that older consumers are. So they're more likely to engage in these new mechanics without leaving the storyline or the context. This is a key point in how you're developing games in the future. Who's your future consumer? How do they think? It's different. Trust me. So what if we could engage the older audience into interactive content? What would that look like? Well, Intel spent a good decade buying companies and building technology to do this. They deployed it in sports, right? Best place to do this, because that technology platform, you've got a clean area to deploy the machine vision technology, and there's pivotal moments that you want to replay or see or slow-mo. So this is interesting. 50 million people in the US watch football. None of them play it. So how can I engage those people to watch content on my brand and not play it? We start to use mechanics like this, right? So something super interesting. Now this isn't a product just yet, because it's very, very compute heavy, and the distribution medium and the viewing platform don't really exist. You'll probably see this in the next 5 years or so, to the point where you'll have 40 interactive control of your sports content. This will change how linear content is consumed. Well, what if I can take that into story content? Once again, this is some Intel tech from 5 years ago or so. This is full volumetric linear content of an entire dramatic film scene, right? What if you can be the director, watch this content the way you want? What if this extends a brand, maybe Red Dead Redemption, you played the game, maybe they have a movie, Red Dead, right? You watch the movie, or maybe the movie is slightly interactive so that you can direct it. Anyway, so that's what I said meant by driving it off a cliff. We basically just went through what is the future of content design. It's not about game development. It's about consumers. It's about entertainment. It's about interactivity. It's about platform. It's about your ecosystem, finding solutions, technologies, collaborations. Thank you.